and welcome to this edition of Frozen Cups and Hot Chips Podcast. I'm your host, Terrell Ducree. We're at the Renaissance Portsmouth Waterfront Hotel, and I'm here with one of its native sons, Mr. Davy Smith III, also affectionately known as Money. Davy, welcome to Frozen Cups and Hot Chips Podcast.
Hey, bro. Thank you, man. It's a plumb pleasing pleasure to be on the show, brother. I thank you for the time and the platform and the chance to tell my story. Thank you, sir.
Oh, we're going to get into it. Extremely humbled to have you, and thank you as well.
Yes, sir.
Always keeping the fresh merch, and of course, we'll touch on that in a minute.
Yes, sir.
Hold tight. You know, as I mentioned, one of the native sons to Portsmouth, born and raised. And Davy, I know that this city is certainly a friend to you. And of course, with your passion, it's essential to your soul. Tell our viewers about Portsmouth, Virginia.
Well, Portsmouth is it's a small city. Well, I say this, it's a small city with a big city feel. Everybody's your neighbor. We got about 96,000 people here. It's very diverse. A place where the Underground Railroad sits here at the AME church here. Actually, they ran right down here to the Elizabeth River. And there's so many things going on. The Norfolk Naval Shipyard we have over here. A beautiful city, man. It has a lot of history. Yes, sir.
Now, that's just the brief tip of the iceberg, because Davy, of course, has layers to this city. Davy, you're out of Jeffrey Wilson Homes, a well-known neighborhood, and we're going to talk one of the most notorious neighborhoods
Yes, sir.
Southeastern Virginia. Talk to me about your childhood growing up.
Well, growing up, my folks, they started out in Newtown. You know, that's where a lot of African Americans were back then, congregated down here in downtown. And then from there, it was Prentice Park, and by the age of three, I was in Jeffrey Wilson Homes. And man, yes, I've seen some things, brother. Anywhere from, I had my good times, but I can't say this. I seen the drugs, I seen the alcohol, I seen the domestic violence, I seen a lot of things, but also I seen a lot of good too. They had programs in place like PRHA. We had our own baseball league. Thankful to Mr. Tyrone Hines for starting the T-ball league. Thankful for Miss Peoples with the frozen cups.
Okay.
You know, and Miss Bueller with the hot chips.
Yes.
I mean, those things like that were tremendous and made a difference. And now, and I know we'll get to this later, I humbly serve on the Housing Authority Board that I grew up in, and now I'm the chairman of that board.
Proverbially putting your money where your mouth is.
Yes,
no
sir.
Pun intended.
Yes, sir.
Now, of course, you are an IC Norcom graduate. You know, quite a lineage with that institution, that high school. My
yes,
mother
sir.
Also attended
awesome.
As well. Talk to me about IC Norcom. For all of us that didn't go, and in particular,
gotcha.
Talk to me about 2:30 after school in the parking lot of the Turnpike Norcom, because, and I'm sure you can elaborate
that,
further,
yes.
There is a difference to that Turnpike Norcom. Talk to me about Turnpike Norcom and that parking lot after school.
Turnpike Norcom and that parking lot after school, it was a lot of great energy, because you had your athletes, and then you had your regular folks. And man, I say this, you even had folks come across the street from Jeffrey Wilson that didn't go to the school, and I ended up going to the school because I ended up moving my grandma. You know, some things happened with my family, you know, dysfunction, things happen, you know. But that experience at Norcom at 2:30, you know, I had to start getting ready to get my snack or whatever I had to get, because I played football, so I couldn't stay for so long. I would probably be down at the bus ramp peeking, all at the guys that do got license and drive, and then they say, you know, I'm beelining back down there, because I know I got to get ready to practice.
How about that?
Yes, sir.
He mentioned practice. Davy is certainly a top-tier athlete. And when did football become your passion?
Football became a passion actually around about 9 years old, just playing around out there in Jeffrey Wilson. And matter of fact, we used to play our games, our little tackle football games, right in front of Norcom, one turnpike where the band room was,
okay.
On that lawn of grass. We played football right there, all the time. I remember running around and playing with the guys, and if you're playing wide receiver, you would say you Jerry Rice,
okay.
Or you get in the backfield, you saying you Roger Craig, or you Bo Jackson, you know. And if you was a linebacker, you said, man, I'm Singleton today, you know. And those things right there, I said, man, you know what? I'm gonna go to Norfolk one day and play football. And long story short, I started off at Churchland High School.
Okay.
I went to Churchland all the way up to my sophomore year, and then my light bulb went off. I'm from the hood. Football was my vehicle. It was a tool. And I said, you know what? It's gonna get me out. I got to Norfolk, got with Coach Langston, and discipline was there, but man, they drove that thing home, you know.
You know, you mentioned Coach Langston, another legend,
mm-hmm.
In Portsmouth. Portsmouth football coach, IC Norcom Portsmouth football coach, and something else that I wanted to piggyback on that you mentioned, you came out of Jeffrey Wilson Holmes and you saw everything, but yet you were still able to persevere through some of those challenges. A lot of your you know, neighborhood kids growing up, some of your classmates didn't necessarily follow that path. What was it that you saw out of those eyes that helped you pick another choice for yourself?
To be honest, I was 13 years old when it really happened. I was sitting in the backseat of the car. It's my brother, Smoke, Bolo. And yeah, I'm dropping names.
It is.
But I was 13 years old when they said, hey, let's put them on. And my brother looked at Bolo through the rearview mirror and said, nah, he going to school to play ball. And I seen that my brother really cared about me. And that took that thing to a whole nother level. Smoke looked at him and nodded his head. And they didn't let me touch it. They didn't let me get involved. I seen a lot of stuff.
Sure.
Seen a lot of stuff now. And you make a movie out there. Y'all gonna be producers.
That's right, you heard it here.
Put it out there, yeah. But and that right there did it for me. When I knew my brother cared, he didn't want me to get in that life of that game. That made a big difference.
It also takes a village, as they always
yes,
say.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Not only that, we're gonna touch on the fact that some people need to outstart something in you.
Mm-hmm.
We're also gonna touch on some of those that didn't have that blessing of someone seeing the value in them. We're gonna talk youth violence enforcement, which has been plagued as of late. We're gonna go into football, we're gonna talk collegiate, and we're gonna also speak about your ascending into the political realm. We got everything here. Stay tuned. We're going to take a brief break and we'll be right back right here on Frozen Cups and Hot Chips Podcast.
This is your boy Dre Black tuning in to you from the Renaissance down in P-Town. Make sure you tune in to Frozen Cups and Hot Chips.
Welcome back to Frozen Cups and Hot Chips Podcast. Davy, in our earlier segment, we were talking about you being at a crossroads and having to make an important decision in the remainder of your life. I want you to elaborate on that.
Well, at about the age of 13 to 15, it got real shaky. You know, my mom, I can say it, my mom was stressed out on, she was out on crack.
Okay.
My brother, he was selling, surviving, doing whatever he had to do. My dad was back and forth, and I had to find a vehicle, man, and football became that vehicle, you know, playing sports all the time with my friends. And then by the time I got to my freshman year at Churchland High School, I started getting an organized ball. But the one thing I do remember that stuck with me the most, I think I was 13 or 14 years old, my brother said to his friend Bolo, he's not gonna sell drugs, he's not gonna do that, he's gonna go to school, he's gonna play ball, he's gonna do this. And that light bulb went off, and I seen that my brother put that energy in me that he believed in me, and that meant a lot. And very grateful for that. And look at that, whew, just like the fire.
Boy, that was biblical, wasn't it? How about that?
And
Shekinah in there.
Yes, sir. That flame. That's right. Come on now, methane, baby, methane blue.
Yes.
That's what it really is. But let's continue.
We'll get to that in a moment.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Sidebar. We, you know, Davy and myself, both members of the greatest fraternity, Omega Psi Phi. Shameless plug. Aye. Yes.
Yes, sir.
You know, you received a scholarship to Norfolk State.
I actually did. Yes, sir.
Coming from Jeffrey Wilson Holmes and some of those obstacles that you mentioned.
Coming from Jeffrey Wilson Holmes, and by the time I got to Norcom, I was out of Jeffrey Wilson and I was with my grandmother.
Okay.
And it was actually 17 of us in a 3-bedroom house, real talk.
Okay.
Real talk. So anybody that's African American can relate when you're living with your grandma.
No doubt.
Is everybody, me, my cousin, my auntie.
Two at the headboard, two at the foot.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And that time right there was a trying time. My senior year, my athletic ability along with my scholastic ability, the two came together. And you know, I met that quota, got up to that 2.6 where I needed to be.
Yeah, I've been there.
And, I got offered a football scholarship, man, to Norfolk State University. And I never forget it, January 24, 1998, I was on my official visit at Norfolk State University. And that same day, that morning, I went to take the SAT because I was trying to qualify so I could play my freshman year. And it meant a lot, you know. I went to go take the test, man, and came out the test, man. I said, man, I got a headache, man. That test was that hard? But come to find out, I didn't know at that time, my head started hurting, that my mom ascended. And I didn't really get into that story, but what happened to my mom is she was brutally beaten by a boyfriend over drugs. So that's why I'm a great proponent against domestic violence and protection of womanhood at all costs.
Say it again.
Protection of womanhood at all costs.
Mm-hmm.
And
And it was a trying time, man. My brother was incarcerated. He had got a murder charge. And I had some decisions to make. And it was like one of those decisions where, you know, do you go back and get the guy and retaliate? Mm. But then, you know, the Most High, God, you know, sat on my heart and said, nah, you can't do that. You got to be the one to change the generational curse.
You know, not only did you lose your mother, which is, you know, just something that, you know, unless it's happened, and it's insurmountable. And then you have the tangible person who was responsible for the fortitude that it took for you to go an alternate path, you know, because some people in our culture,
yes,
you know, we're supposed to avenge that.
That's right.
You know, yeah. we can't express our feelings. We have to man up, mm-hmm, instead of, you know, expressing our feelings. And you took obviously a different path. We're not going to keep it there,
gotcha,
because what you did was you obviously traversed that and turned it into a positive. I want to fast forward now. Of course, we're sitting here at the Renaissance Portsmouth Waterfront Hotel, and you know, I want to talk about your city aspirations municipally. I used to run the municipal television station here for the city of Portsmouth for about 10 years, and I actually filmed the ribbon cutting here at the Renaissance. I'm going to name drop a few. Dr. James Holly III,
yes,
you know, our frat brother as well,
took
really good care of me as a youngster coming out of Norfolk State as well.
Awesome.
One of my first jobs out of college was running the municipal television station.
Awesome.
As a youth. You know, Charles Whitehurst, Cameron Pitts, Ron Massey was the city manager, and I mention those names because this hotel, the crown jewel here on the Elizabeth River,
gotcha,
it was their brainchild. You have a significant story about Mayor Holly as well.
Yes, Mayor Holly, I remember him all the way back to high school when he was talking to us my senior year before my football game. And I remember when I had gotten the LEFCO.
Mm.
The LEFCO.
LEFCO.
Van LEFCO,
yes,
leadership. You know?
I remember.
And I went through that program, and it was a surreal moment because at the graduation, I didn't have to have a piece of paper. I spoke from my heart.
Mm.
And I said, it's amazing to me to be in the same room right now with the mayor that spoke to me when I was in high school. Don Comer is sitting here. I remember wearing the baseball jersey from, mm-hmm, your dad that gave it to me. And Horace Savage, I was the first recipient of your scholarship.
Horace Savage.
Dr. Horace Savage, which happened, sure, to be a frat brother to Omega Roof.
Right.
And, you know, he's still living.
That's right.
Mayor Holly now is in what we call when you ascend the Omega chapter.
That's right.
And in our fraternity. And it was that moment right there, like, I'm serving where I'm supposed to be. And at that time, I got appointed, mm, to the Planning Commission. I was already serving on boards and commissions. And I got appointed to the Planning Commission.
Mm.
And from there, and Ray Smith, shameless plug.
That's right.
He's been helping me ever since I was in the fourth grade, and he was my referral,
yes,
to getting, mm, on the board, and I believe he was on council at the time. So I ended up getting on the Planning Commission board. My first year I served on the board. That second year I became vice chair.
Mm.
The last quarter of being the vice chair, I became chair, and I was chair from there out. My peers voted me back in every, mm, time. And I got a lot done with the development and things behind the scenes in the city, which led up to when I was coming out, I applied for Economic Development Authority.
Mm.
I got bumped to PRHA.
EDA is significant.
Yes, sir. Economic Development. And here, and still, an arm of Economic Development is still Portsmouth Redevelopment Housing Authority.
That's right.
Most people don't know that. They think, mm, it's just housing. No, it's redevelopment as well, too. So we bring in commercial businesses, get things done like that, of that nature. And that brings us back to Mayor Holly.
Mm-hmm.
The irony of this, I went down to the AME church one day, and I was just doing some research, looking at the Underground Railroad, where it was, and something said, go look at that little plaque over there. And I went to go read this little historical plaque of Lincolnsville, which was the first black community in the city of Portsmouth, 1890,
mm,
where you see the hospital in Old Town and everything over there now. It was over there, right over there, about 53 acres.
Okay.
So as I was reading, it struck me that Mayor Holly was born in the house across the street they kept up. The other irony is, his birthday is November 24th,
mm,
1929, quote me on that. My birthday is November 25th, 1978.
Wow.
Here it is, I'm reading this thing. Jeffrey Wilson, which I grew up in Jeffrey Wilson Homes.
Bring it back.
That gentleman lived in Lincolnsville. You tying it?
Mm.
James Holly, Dr. James Holly, lived in Lincolnsville. Jeffrey Wilson came from where?
Lincolnsville.
what I end up living, Jeffrey Wilson.
Jeffrey Wilson, bringing it full going, circle.
Ossie Norcom. What That's was right. Ossie Norcom from? Lincolnsville. Mm. It went full circle for me. I was supposed to do everything, and everything I was supposed to go to was for me.
Yes.
So to persevere and to be relentless about what I want out of life, you tell me I can't have something, I'm gonna smile at you.
How about that? We cut from the same cloth, you know, and you mentioned Dr. Horace Savage, you know, doing tremendous work.
Yes, sir.
With HIV/AIDS in our community, and would be remiss if I didn't mention that. You know, you, as a youth, kind of like myself, it parallels when I was working for the city. I was young amongst all of my colleagues who had 2 and 3 decades of experience. Talk to us about, you know, the Planning Commission, getting your civics engagement enhanced. How was that being a youth with not having as much experience and some of those with more trying to come at you a different way?
Well, it was that experience. It was surreal. It was great because it kind of got fast tracked. And what I did when I went in, I wasn't afraid to ask to go to training. So I started going to training and I started meeting other planning commissioners. I wasn't afraid to go on there and talk with the people in planning and start learning how this process works, how engineering works, how zoning works. And I ain't gonna lie, I took that information that I learned and I became a consultant. Smith Consulting and Networking LLC was created because I was on the planning commission. And see, and the beautiful part about that, after planning, and you saw this, you recorded the meeting.
That's right.
You know, they seen that I carried myself well, and he knows what he's doing. And lo and behold, they had some dysfunction at the housing authority, and they cleaned the board, and I had got appointed. And I just thank God, man. It is what it is. I just thank God for
that's good.
Allowing
that's,
me.
We live. That's the microphone. You good?
Allowing me to be in the place I'm in to give back to my city here at the mouth of the port, as we call it. You know, and. I'm real excited about it. But at PRHA, in 3 years under my leadership, and I became the chair, but the board voted in by my peers when I got there. And we've done about, I say about 51 million in development and probably about 6 million in acquisitions. Quote me on that. But to do that in 3 years and turn it around, man, it's blessing, it's humbling. And I know I can do the work and I'm humble about it, you know? You know what happens when you do good, people want to put you out front. And I've learned to play both roles, to be out front, but also to play back too.
We like to call it being thoroughly immersed. And sir, that's exactly what you are. And Portsmouth certainly is reaping the benefits from it. We're going to touch on some more on that. We're going to go to break so much with Davy Smith III. We appreciate you all watching. We'll be right back right here on Frozen Cups and Hot Chips Podcast.
Hey, this is Davy Smith III, and I'm coming to you live here on Frozen Cups and Hot Chips here on the Elizabeth River, representing Portsmouth, Virginia. Just a kid from Portsmouth, the mouth of the port. Hey, man, I'll see you at the top.
Welcome back to Frozen Cups and Hot Chips Podcast. And yes, our gracious host, the Portsmouth Renaissance and Waterfront Hotel and Conference Center, has allowed this podcast to kind of take up a residency. This is our new home. And they've done some new amenities, Portsmouth. The suites that we're in, we're up on the 10th floor here on the Elizabeth River, and they've done some new amenities trying to compete with some of the new additions down at the oceanfront and some of the lodging throughout our region. The Renaissance Hotel definitely has a treat for you. And, you know, just wanted to show you all some of the digs. A little larger, with obviously more room within. King size bed, I'm not gonna jump on that. And, you know, we are gonna be in the Renaissance Portsmouth Waterfront Hotel a couple of more times hosting Frozen Cups and Hot Chips Podcast. We've also got some specialty nights. We're a partner with the Renaissance. We're grateful that they want Frozen Cups and Hot Chips as a partner as well. So stay tuned for more incentives with the Renaissance Hotel that we're going to bring you through our show. And of course, with this magnificent room, pause, but I'm sharing it with my frat brother, the star of the show, Mr. Davy Smith III. Davy, we're in here looking at some of the new digs out here on the Elizabeth River, the riverfront here, and the Renaissance itself in Portsmouth. How ironic of a name, the Renaissance. But, you know, as of late, man, we're going to switch gears. I mean, we've talked politics, we've talked about your upbringing in this magnificent city, but there's also a dark cloud. I've also heard that the sun shines different in Portsmouth sometimes. We've had an uptick in youth violence. There was a sensational video that went viral with some young men with some heavy firepower. And, you know, we need to, I mean, we're just going to keep it a buck. We need to reach the youth. What's going on in Portsmouth?
there's a whole lot going on, brother. Like you said, we need to reach our youth. I just pray and hope that we can get back to mentoring. You know, COVID doesn't help. I know there's another way we can use technology and still, you know, communicate, but you know and I know, just being present like this, a lot of times when it comes to a youth or a young child, the thing they're looking for is called time, which time is love. And we missing that again. Like when I had those brothers come into the community to mentor us and guide us, you know, you can't get there by yourself, you know. We all have to be taught, but at the same time, though, the individual has to be willing. Because they say, if you know better, you do better.
You know, you spoke on it. It takes, I hate to use that cliche, it takes a village, but it also takes individuals like that time in the car with people that were close to you that said, nah, I don't want him going that route. Where are those mentors? Matter of fact, where are those men in the community? Where, and you know what? You know, some of those men that have checkered past, that have influence in the streets. Sometimes we can't let these youngsters just bang it out and try to fend for themselves. We were all young at some point.
That's right.
We all had to grow and mature. I think there's some leadership needs to come from the lions to also tell these younger cubs that's not the way, and to hold them accountable.
That's right. And it kind of reminds me of Simba paradox. Somebody telling you one thing, but also this person over here trying to give you the good stuff. And you know what it is, the allure, as what you call it, it pulls me back in.
Yes.
You know, some get caught up in that whirlwind. And it's all about choices and decisions too. And then don't get me wrong, some are forced into the game. Because of that self-esteem or this in the third or to threaten a family member. We know this happens, you know. And like you said, we're keeping it 100. It does happen in our community. It happens in every community.
Yes.
You know, just like they say, there's a such thing as black on black violence. No, people kill and shoot people they know. Let's be real.
All of them.
Whether you're white or black, you look at the demographics. That person, one way or another, knew that person.
Yes.
Unless it was just a mass shooting and something just happened. That's, you know how that stuff goes down that way. But people keep saying we need to have a discussion. No, we need solutions. It's like real estate.
We're talking enough.
Like they say, real estate is what? Location, location, location. Right now, you know what we need? Solutions, solutions, solutions.
I like that.
So, just as well, you can assist me, I can assist you. You know, we can't do it by ourselves. We got to come together. We need that synergy back. We need to become, in the African culture, as we say, you know I'm Yoruba Nigerian, by the way, too. We are communal people by nature.
Yes.
First thing you do, like if you came to my house, what's my wife or my mom or somebody gonna say? You're hungry,
yes,
you want
we're gonna
something,
feed
eat something, you want
yes.
something. We gotta get back to that.
Yes.
But it's tough, don't get me wrong, that's an uphill battle.
And we as a people are forgiving people and
yes.
we welcome everyone.
Yeah, we are.
When I look at even the Charleston shooting, I go back to it, that congregation welcomed that young man and we are welcoming people and we're so forgiving, even when we're wrong. That's a whole nother story.
Yeah.
But I wanna say to Portsmouth, to the residents, to that youth, to those youth that are out there, you're not by yourself. There are some folk who aren't necessarily afraid to speak to you, but we want to make sure that you're willing to listen. And we'll drop the jewels. We want you to make it longer. We want you to graduate. We want you to get beyond 18 to 20 years old. You got classmates that are losing their children.
Yes, sir. True. Yes,
know,
I do. Classmates that are losing their children every day. And we got to get back to communicating. I can disagree with you and not get pointed at angry where I got to pull my weapon or hit you. I ain't got to do that. We can work this out. We can figure this out. That's called communication, but it's also called business one-on-one.
Yes. And not only that, I mean, faith in a friend. I mean, you know, hey, at the end of the day, you know, you got to love your brother, love
that's
your
right.
sister. You know, we're going to switch gears because as you can tell, the good brother has done a wardrobe change. You know, you are not just into marketing your brand. It's a science. I want you to elaborate not only on these pieces that we're seeing in the show, but talk to me about what's next for Davy Smith.
What's next for Davy Smith? I'm planning to do the public speaking thing. That's a gift. That's a passion. That's something I really want to do. I already created the website for that. It's ds3inspires.com. Created for that. People keep asking, when you going to run for public office? So I just smile when they ask me that.
Hey, but, you heard it here first.
But just, and one of my mentors, Roy Tatum, Roy says it all the time. And he got it from Mr. Stone Cypher, when it was a prepaid legal shield.
Okay.
And it still sticks with me. I want to make a living while making a difference. And remember, you got to be selfish for a moment.
Talk to him.
Till you get yourself together so you can come back and be selfless. Think about it again, what I said. You got to be selfish so you can come back and be selfless. So if I do get to another level, get to another, just at the third, it's going to take some time. I'm going to have to take some time away to do that, to focus. But I got to do that. And you got to do that for yourselves too. So borrow my belief in you till your belief kicks in. And you know, and this ain't just about a black thing. This is about the human race. I'm going to say it again. Human race. Okay?
There it is.
That's the only race it is. So remember that at the end of the day, man.
You know, when you're on an airplane, just to piggyback off of that, I'll use my analogy.
Go ahead, sir.
You know, in an airplane, the stewardess always tells you to put the mask on yourself before you can put it on others.
Yes, sir.
And the lesson in that is that you can't do anything for anyone else unless you're feeding yourself. Mm-hmm. So that selfish piece, not being selfish overall, but make sure that you're taking care of your core so that you can give out to others. Davy Smith III, this has certainly been a pleasure. There is so many endeavors that I know that you are partaking in, and of course, we want to have you back on Frozen Cups and Hot Chips podcast to chart that growth. I know you're going to do great things. Good frat brother, I know it's COVID, but I'm going to touch your hand. I certainly will touch your hand. Thank you so much for coming on the show. We want to tell you thank you for watching Frozen Cups and Hot Chips podcast. You absolutely will never know who's going to be on there. And of course, my guests are always the experts. We'll see you next time.